In this video, I'm going to show you exactly how I recreated a Studio Ghibli scene in Blender. More specifically, it's the super popular scene from the anime movie My Neighbour Totoro, and this is what my result looks like. It took me around 3 weeks to get it from start to finish because I really didn't want to rush it. And honestly, I'm super proud of how it turned out, and I'm very excited to show you guys how I made it. But before we start, I just quickly want to tell you that this scene is available on my Gumroad, Blender Market, and Patreon pages. So if you want to break it down for yourself while also supporting me and my channel, you can buy this or any of my other products from the links given down in the description. For those of you who can't afford it, don't worry, just keep watching and you should have a pretty good idea of how to make such a scene of your own. I also want to point out right away that this is not supposed to be a step-by-step tutorial of any kind. However, I will be going over the major workflows, share my thought process, and give you guys some tips and tricks along the way in detail. So with all of that said, let's get right into it. First up, let's take a look at all of these references that I collected for this project. I have these variations of the same scene from the same angle but from different times. I also have close-up and other angles of the characters which will help me understand their proportions a bit better than just the front view. A little disclaimer before we move on though, I am very bad at making characters. I've only made one teddy character before this project, so I'm really sorry if you find any newbie errors in my workflow. Since I had no idea where to really start, I decided to watch a course on Blender Cloud about creating style characters. From there, I picked up some great ideas which I will share with you as we move on. I started off the project by creating Totoro first, who is arguably the most important subject in the shot. His body's base shape was made using a sphere which I bisected and mirrored to get a shape like this. With this, I dived straight into sculpting mode, turned on dynamic topology set to constant detail with a resolution of 20. Then to change the current mesh into a high poly mesh with the provided resolution, we can just hit this detail flood fill button. With that done, we can now move on to smoothing the harsh edges to get a smooth clay-like blob like this. Next, I use a grab brush to tone the front of his body to create his belly. Before we add anything else, we can create some placeholder hands by using the snake hook brush so that we have a better idea of the proportions of his body. The same technique of using the snake hook brush can also be used in the case of his feet. Since we aren't going to pose him in any other way later, we might as well create his feet right away. So that's what I did, and I also used some other brushes like the crease, smooth, scrape and flatten brushes to define the shape better. Now here's me wasting my time on the arms, which I ended up removing anyway because it would be impossible to pose them with such a high poly mesh. Now for Totoro's ears, I used a separate cube object with a mirror modifier applied to it. I added an empty object to the middle of the scene and used it as the mirror object so that everything that we do is mirrored over to the other side properly, regardless of where our origin point may be. It was just some extruding, scaling and rotating to get the basic shape of his ear done. Again, I went into sculpting mode, dyntopo with resolution 40, detail flood fill, and then started smoothing the edges out. I also used the snake hook brush to add this pointed end to the ear. Now this, in no way resembles Totoro's ears, so we need to add some details to it and further refine the shape. To start off, I switched the dynamic topology option to relative detail with the detail size set to 3. Unlike constant detail, where higher resolutions mean higher density of the mesh, here the smaller the detail size, the more dense are the subdivisions. Now yet again, I use the scrape, smooth, inflate, grab and flatten brushes to work on the mesh. If you don't want to move your cursor over to the tool shelf over and over again to access your brushes, you can simply right click on them and assign a shortcut or add them to quick favorites to quickly access them while you're working. This will let you press Q on your keyboard to bring up a smaller menu to access your brushes right where your cursor is. Anyway, after tweaking the size of the ears a bit, I added a boolean modifier on the body object and selected the object to be the ear objects with the method set to union. Then we can apply this modifier, delete the ear objects because they're embedded with the body object. This will allow us to merge and smooth out the edges between the head and the ear so that they feel more connected. After that, it's just some tweaking that I did for a couple of minutes till I was sort of satisfied with how it looked. Next up, I added a little bump on the head using the snake hook brush to make his mouth. With some smoothing and creases, I felt it was looking more like Totoro than a prototype piglet. I also scaled it to make him a bit thinner because he was just too fat right now to be able to fly. To make the nose, I used dyntopo with relative density, zoomed in on that area and used the clay strips brush to subdivide that area. With that out of the way, we now have enough geometry to create the mask from, so we can do that by pressing M to switch over to the mask brush and paint something that resembles his nose. After that, we need to invert the mask and use the snake hook brush to pull out the additional geometry from the mask area to work with. Now we can just smooth the edges out and call it done for now. I decided to add the eyes next because I needed to have an idea of whether or not this thing would actually look like the character I'm going for. So I added a UV sphere with the same kind of mirror modifier as the ears and positioned them appropriately. We also need to tone the area around the eyes so that they look like they belong there. And just to preview the iris, I just sculpted this super scary bump at the center to get an idea. I did some additional tweaking, mostly with the ears because I felt like they were too close to each other right now, and I just tried to give them a more blocky look. I also added some crease around the nose to define its shape better. I took this chance to also add the nostrils using the crease brush and also his cute little frown. The next important step for me was to define his belly area, which has a lighter color to it. I first masked out that part and used a layer brush with a relatively low height to protrude the masked area out a bit to get his belly defined like so. I also wanted to know how his nails would fit with this model so far, so I just used cubes with subsurf modifiers to quickly add his nails. I also wanted to see how they would look on his feet, so I tweaked his feet a bit before doing so. At this point, he looked pretty complete to me as a first draft, so I decided to move on to making his pose, which would require a fair amount of work since we can't really just rig a high poly mesh, and the pose brush in sculpt mode wouldn't give us that good of a result. So first up, what I did was I went to edit mode and used the bisect tool to remove his arms. Then in sculpt mode, I just added some extra geometry there and smoothed it out. To make his arms again, we're going to use separate objects. I used a cube and made a curvy shape like this. Now I switched to sculpt mode again, where I used dynamic topology again to add more geometry and then smoothed it out. We can tweak the shape of the arm to our liking in this phase. After I was happy with the shape, I duplicated it to get the other arm. Since this arm would be holding the umbrella, we need to deform it to match the reference. I used a pose brush for this and kind of rotated it to the front like he was pointing a gun or something. I joined both of these arms to the body using a Boolean modifier once again. Now the merge operation won't look too good because of how messy our topology is, and smoothing it won't help either. So we're going to fix that by using the voxel remesher here. Use a voxel size of 0.01 meter and then hit the remesh button. This will make a much cleaner mesh based on the volume of the object. Then we can freely smooth out the nasty parts and crease them however we like. I positioned the nails on the left hand and also added a cylinder to represent the umbrella while we work on the other hand. Finally, it was time to add the whiskers, which I did by adding thin cylinders with a lot of loop cuts and used proportional editing to curve them like I needed to. I also added some little bumps to make it look like hair follicles. With all of that done, this is what our final Totoro looks like. Not to mention, we might need to make some simple tweaks like exaggerating the creases later on, but for now, this is good enough. After Totoro, I knew I had to make Satsuki, but I knew my limits and I was aware that I could never make my first character look so awesome right off the bat. So I decided to get a head start using a girl base mesh. I started off by selecting every body part except the eyes and joined them into a single object and dropped a subsurf modifier to get some more geometry. Then I used the voxel remesher in sculpt mode to make every piece connected to each other. This is much better than the Boolean method and produces cleaner results when your mesh is a solid object like this. After that, I used a smooth brush to get rid of the creases. I used the inflate deflate brush and painted over the chest area holding down the control button to invert the effect to match the proportions of Satsuki. Speaking of which, to make her look more like her than just a generic girl, we need to tweak the proportions of the face a bit. So that's what I did next, mainly using the grab and inflate brushes. I also used the draw brush to make the ears as well. Just a simple hollow looking shape without any realistic details. I kept the reference photos up on my second monitor on a program called PureRef and tried to overall go for similar proportions with the 3D model as well. And that also brought me to a point where I had to change the height of her, mainly the need to shorten her legs. But doing that directly in edit mode would be a nightmare because the viewport would lag seriously with such a high poly mesh. A better way to do it would be to use a lattice object. If you haven't used them or heard about them before, then pay attention for a couple of minutes because it's gonna be super helpful in these cases. So I added a lattice object and resized it to the bounds of the character. Next, we need to add a lattice modifier and select the lattice for the object. Make sure you haven't applied the scale in the lattice object in this case because it would give results like these if you have. After that, we can increase the W resolutions of the lattice to about 6. Go to edit mode with it selected, select the bottom vertices and bring it up with proportional editing turned on. This will easily let us resize the bottom part of the character without getting too much of a significant lag. I thought this would be a good time to get an idea of what the hair would look like. I literally spent the most time and also lost some brain cells on this part because I had to try out different ways of making hair. At first, I tried using a sphere to get the basic shape of the hairline and then used a snake hook brush to create the hair. This gave me some insanely ugly results due to my lack of experience, so I ditched that. Next, I tried to paint a mask following the shape of the hair and then used a mask extract tool to create a separate object out of it. I tried to add some flat details on it and it felt like I was heading somewhere with it. But again, as always, I realized it was a massive fail when I tried to create the fuzzy fringes like that on the original character. These techniques could work just fine for some cases, but for this one, I had to take a different route. The technique I use for creating Satsuki's hair is actually quite a common one to my surprise. I was mainly inspired to try this out by the two YouTube creators YanSculpts and DannyMac3D. They are both amazing artists and I recommend that you check them out if you're interested in character creation in Blender. So anyway, in this method, I used a path curve for the hair and used another circle curve as the bevel object, which let me control the shape of the hair using this circle curve independently. I also added a bezier curve which I used for the taper object of the hair curve. You can treat this bezier curve as a falloff curve, so whatever falloff you create here will reflect on the hair strand. To make the hair shapes, I duplicated this hair curve, scaled it down, deleted everything in edit mode, and used the draw curve tool to draw the hair shapes directly using my tablet instead of duplicating and tweaking the shapes over and over again. So I kept drawing those curves, occasionally duplicating some strands that seemed to fit perfectly in another spot, and just tweak them around whenever I needed to. I mainly focus on getting it to look good from the front view since the back won't be visible anyway. Now after I got the flat hair looking good enough, I duplicated the whole object, scaled it down and deleted everything in edit mode once again. Then I used the same method to draw the fringes as well. It looked exactly like what I had in mind, unlike the previous methods I tried, and it also gave me a lot more control over the look and placement. I duplicated and tweaked it once again for the other side to get some variation. And that was all I did to create the hair. I was honestly super proud of how it looked. Next, I started modeling the clothes. I started off with a cube and adjusted its shape roughly to match her torso. It doesn't need to be extremely accurate at this point because we're going to tweak it later anyway. Then I used a subsurf modifier on it to smooth it out and did some additional tweaks. I also separated the shirt from the skirt part, and to make it look tucked in, I scaled out the bottom edge loop of the shirt mesh, extruded and scaled it in, and finally beveled the other edge loop to make it a bit sharper for now. For the collar, I added a cylinder with no cap fill and positioned it around the neck. I hid the bottom set of vertices and started tweaking the top ones by themselves. Once I was happy with the basic shape, I brought the edge loop back and started extruding from the top edge loop to create the rest of the shape. After that, there were more tweaks to be made to the shirt and the skirt as well. Now, I wanted to work on the straps of the pinafore, which I created using a cylinder again. I scaled and positioned it roughly around where I wanted it, and then deleted the bottom few edges of the loop. Then, with proportional editing and snapping to face enabled, I started moving the edges around to snap them onto the shirt. Once I was happy with it, I extruded the bottom part and extended it down a bit. I added a solidify modifier on the shirt, straps, collar, and skirt as well. Then I applied the subsurf modifier on the shirt and started tweaking it in sculpt mode. I basically smoothed out the tucked in part which was too sharp at the moment. I used the cloth brush to add the creases on the mesh, and this brush is honestly my favorite. It's just so easy to get good looking results. I mainly added the creases around the bottom part, near the straps, armpits, and around the collar. Additionally, I spread out some more creases around some other areas like the sleeves. I also applied the subsurf modifier on the collar and added some tiny details on it in sculpt mode. Then once again, I applied the subsurf on the skirt, went to sculpt mode, and started adding the details, mostly the compression near the area where the straps will connect, and also use this cloth brush to add more details. I did the same for the straps as well to finish it off. Next, I wanted to make the gum boots, which I did by masking out the feet using a box mask and then using the mask extract tool to turn it into a separate object. Then I used a remesher in sculpt mode to get some better topology to work with. Since gum boots aren't this tight on the feet, I used the smooth and inflate brushes quite a lot here. Now that's all the modeling part of Satsuki. Next was rigging. I struggled a lot in this part because I despise any kind of rigging. It's just too scary for me. I tried to rig it directly using automatic weights first, but that crashed Blender every time I tried because the mesh was just too dense to be rigged and had some weird topology. And if there's one thing I hated more than rigging, that was retopology. So I searched for ways to do it without it and eventually ended up with this program called Instant Meshes. This program sort of automates the retopology process and makes it extremely easy. I heard it from a grant app video video, which I'll link down in the description along with some other resources if you're interested to check it out. So I first exported the body, base mesh, and an OBJ file to load into Instant Meshes. I won't go over how to use this program or how I used it in detail, but you can check out the video I have linked down below for more info. But anyway, this program let me simplify the mesh without losing any details and also get a lot cleaner topology. Obviously, it's not the perfect and the edge loops do not flow in the right direction, but we can get away with it for a simple character like this. After I exported the mesh from Instant Meshes, I imported it into Blender and replaced the original mesh with this one. After this, I exported the boots and retopologized them in the same way. That was all that was needed to be taken care of. I just added a rigify rig with the bones aligned to the respective parts of the mesh. Then I selected the body and then the rig and pressed Ctrl P to bring up this menu, which gives you options to parent your objects, and selected with automatic weights. After that's done, you can see that we have a simple functional rig where the weight painting job is automatically done for us. You can start posing the character to get an idea of how accurate the weight painting job was and then fix any areas which look awkward by using the weight painting mode. I did a similar thing to the other objects as well, selecting them and selecting their rig and then parenting to it with automatic weights. You can expect some issues with the weight paints in this method, but it speeds up our workflow a lot. Since we're only going to view her from the front view, we just need to fix the issues with the weight paint that might be distorting the meshes in the front. A value of 1 will show up as red in the mesh, which means that the selected bone has 100% influence on the painted area. A blue color means that it has no influence whatsoever. Keeping that in mind, just make sure to troubleshoot all the areas and make sure it looks good from the angle that you're viewing it from. With all of that done, we can now move on to the next part. So next up, we're going to add me. I was lucky enough to find a rigged model of Mei online. I posed her roughly like the reference so that she was kind of sitting on Satsuki's back. This helped me understand her proportions better because I had the exact image to refer to. So I made some tweaks to her model, starting off with scaling down the head first. I also tweaked her pose a bit more, hanging the arms down in a more relaxed pose. Then I duplicated the boots from Satsuki and gave them to her as well. I also extended the sleeves of her frock to make it look like a raincoat. To really finish it off, I decided to make the hood by using a cube with a subsurf modifier and a subdivision in edit mode with the smoothness set to 1. After that, it was just tweaking it more and using a solidify and bevel modifier to give it a bit of thickness. I also made sure to weight paint the newly created mesh to the appropriate bones and fix any other issues with it. With those changes, Mei looked pretty close to the reference and I was pretty happy with it. With the characters all done, we can now move on to making the rest of the scene. I made a new project for this and added a nice and big plane for the ground. I added Satsuki and Mei from their project to this main one. The plane needed to be resized, so I did just that. Then I added Totoro and fixed his scaling as well, and I also deleted the placeholder umbrella. I roughly positioned the camera and started modeling the pole at the bus stop, referring to the original image again. It was pretty simple, just a cylinder with some extrusions, a solidified circle for design, and a solidified plane for the metal plate in the middle. I beveled the vertices of this place using the shortcut Ctrl+Shift+B to bevel only the vertices. After some free model hunting online, I found a couple of models that I thought were good enough to be used in the scene. Spending time on making things that can be downloaded for free online, especially ones that aren't very unique to the project, is pretty much pointless. So I got this umbrella model that fits my needs, so I didn't have to model it from scratch, which saved me that much time. Anyway, I took this umbrella and scaled and positioned it on Satsuki first. Then I duplicated it and gave it to Totoro, but had to resize and position it differently. I also added some bumps on the parts where Totoro's ears were in contact. After a few more adjustments, I then added the three models I had lying around, which I thought would fit the scene, but I ended up removing them later and making my own models. But they acted as pretty good placeholders for now. Then I sculpted some bumps on the ground as well to make it less even. I added some vegetation that I got online for free again, and they were super high quality. I had to set up the materials manually because they were from Sketchfab, and for some reason the node wrangler shortcut for adding the principal texture setup didn't work on these textures, probably because of the naming convention. I did make a particle system which I thought I'd use for the final scene, but I'll be removing this as well, as you'll see later. But this too helped me get an idea of where the vegetation will be going. After that, I set up some basic colors for Satsuki and Totoro. For Totoro, I also needed to start texture or vertex painting his belly, but both of these modes were lagging pretty hard on my crappy laptop, so I instead made a mask and sculpt mode. mode with his fur pattern as well, and using the mask tools add-on, I saved the mask to a vertex group. Then I went to vertex paint mode and went to paint vertex colors from weight to convert the selected vertex group into a vertex paint job. I inverted the mask, went to shading workspace, and in Totoro's material, I added a vertex color node and selected the vertex color that we just created. Now we can use this as a mask to mix between two colors using a mix node and controlling the factor input, and basically convert the black part of the mask into a dark gray with a brown tint by changing the color of the first slot. The second color slot can be a light off-white or skin tone color for his belly. I looked at the reference closely to see what color would fit the best for the 3D model. I also added the rest of the materials like the nails and whiskers. Again, I went into vertex paint mode after creating a new vertex color and painted his nose white. Then I used another mix node and vertex color node to mix in the black part of his nose. This looks pretty good for now. I realized that May's model already had some open eyes painted right on the model, so to make her look like she was sleeping, I decided to pull the hoodie down even more and painted away the eye that was visible with the surrounding skin colors. Moving on, I decided to add Totoro's fur before anything else. I watched a few tutorials on how to do it and found this one that I had previously watched by Anita Ravelji, which was actually super helpful. So I did something similar in my model, although not as good. I have used two hair particle systems here, one for the belly fur and other one for the body fur, since they both have different colors. I'd highly recommend referring to the video I mentioned if you want to make animal fur, because mine is a bit of a watered down version of it anyway. But what I did was that I copied the vertex group that I created earlier for the vertex paint mask and also removed the weights from the eyes so that we have no fur there. The belly fur's weight paint is just an inverted version of this. For their materials, I used the principal hair BSDF with the default settings except the colors, which I copied from the underlying material of the base mesh. With a few more tweaks to his materials, like adjusting the materials and stuff, I was done making Totoro. Following this, I decided to work on Satsuki next, so I unwrapped her body. Well, I UV unwrapped the base mesh using Smart UV Project because we're only going to be texture painting directly in Blender, so the seams do not matter too much. But we can maximize the space used by the island's form so as to get a higher texel density. I'm using a paid add-on called UVPackMaster for this, which automatically packs your islands in the most efficient way possible without any overlapping. All you have to do is hit this pack button and it'll take care of everything for you. If you're interested, I'll have a link down below in the description to where you can get this add-on. Anyway, after that, I created a new texture with a 4096x4096 resolution where we'll be texture painting. So let's apply this texture to our material and go to the texture painting workspace. Here, I filled the whole texture with a skin color. I also decided to not have the eyes as a separate object because I knew that it would just increase my work threefolds and I was already running out of patience for it. So I tried to draw it directly on the model and it was looking fine to me, but the final result still wasn't as good as I expected, which you can call the most major flaw in the scene, I guess. I decided to go for the expression she had in the reference with Totoro without an umbrella because I thought that was pretty funny and iconic to me. I didn't add any tiny details, just whatever I could see on the image. I also used a more saturated skin tone, a bit of a reddish color to paint over some areas like the cheeks. I also used a pink color to draw the oval blushes. Once I was done, I also created another texture for the roughness map. This is just a black and white texture where the darker values mean shinier looks. Next up, I unwrapped the rest of the objects like the shirt, the straps, the skirt, and the collar. Moreover, I also decided to add some more details to the pole. So I went to sculpt mode and sculpted some details using Dyne Topo. A few dents and bumps will do just fine. You can also do that for the metal plates and the sign on top. I also unwrapped them by selecting the edges manually by holding control to pick the shortest path and marking them as seams. Then I moved on to adding the materials to this pole, which were the concrete and metal textures. I also found this photo of the exact pole online, which was extremely helpful to get the details looking identical. So I used the project from view option and aligned the islands to the plate. I did the same for the circular sign. After that, I mixed the metal texture with the pole image texture using a mix node and used the gradient for the mask. Once again, I had to add materials to the umbrellas. I fixed the geometry as well, converting the tris to quads and adding loop cuts to clean up the geometry, and also added bevels to the edges which were supposed to be sharper. Then I just used the principal BSDF setups to quickly add colors to all of the objects following the reference image. The next step for me was to add the textures for Satsuki's clothes. I used some of the fabric textures I found online for this and used a hue saturation value node to modify the colors of the base color texture to add it to both the skirt and the shirt. I also painted a subsurface carrying mask next for Satsuki. Not sure why I did that, it really didn't add much to the look except for render time. And that got us to this point where all of the characters were complete and they were looking gorgeous. Next, I decided to work on the main trees. I simply used some cylinders, unwrapped them and created some textures to paint on. I started off with this unsaturated brown color to fill the whole trunk and I wanted to use a light color in the middle. Before we do that though, let's set the fall off of the brush to smoother. Let's also create a color palette right here so that we can quickly switch between the colors whenever we need them. So with that setup, I started drawing on the trunk. I haven't made a lot of these hand painted textures before, so I was quite new at this, but I quickly got the hang of it and managed to paint them to my satisfaction. However, I made the same mistake I did in my previous project, and that was not saving the image textures on my computer. So whenever you're creating new images in Blender, make sure to hit this button often or press Alt S in this window. I overlooked this little thing and I got into the mess of painting everything all over again because Blender doesn't seem to like the concept of saving the textures anywhere when you just press Ctrl S without actually saving it externally somewhere before. Anyway, we can now move on to shading it. I created a simple roughness map using a color ramp and also made a bump map. So this is what I have for the trees. The final image looks a little worse because I had to redo it, but it really doesn't matter as it's pretty much going to be hidden in the dark background. In the same way, I also hand painted the texture of the ground. I again forgot to save this texture as well, but the second time I did it, it actually looked better, so I'm pretty happy about the accident. More so because now I can properly advise you enough that you need to save your images, guys, because you don't want to end up like me. Luckily, the recordings were intact, so it wasn't a total loss. Anyway, I again made a simple roughness map using a color ramp, and I also mixed some ground roughness and normal map textures I had lying around for some extra details. Speaking of extra details, I made some super simple rock models using cubes and scattered them on the ground using a particle system. For their textures, I again painted some textures. They didn't have to be extremely detailed, so all of the rocks had the same texture. So far, it's looking awesome. I removed the vegetation I had earlier to manually place some myself and have more control over the look. I also created the leaf that you can see here in the reference using a subdivided plane and circle selecting the shape I need. With the subsurf modifier and the relax options in the loop tools, I got this curvy leaf which I tweaked to look even more like the reference. I gave it some thickness as well, and once I was happy with the result, I duplicated it and changed it up and made 3 variants of this leaf. Then I texture painted all of them separately and got a result like this. With the same roughness and bump setup as the trees, I duplicated them around in a similar pattern as the reference. I also selected a few of the foliage models from before and spread them out across the scene in the background. It was now time to add the lighting. I started off with a spotlight first but changed it to a point light soon. I also duplicated this point light to the other side to get some fill lighting. I added a cube with a principal volume shader attached to the volume input of the material output to get some volumetrics in the scene, which we can later turn into fog to get that hazy look in the rain. I also used an HDRI to fake some indirect lighting. In order for the HDRI to be not visible directly to the camera but still have the lighting, I used this setup. Now we can focus on some details. What I did first was that I removed the foliage that was standing out too much in the scene and replaced it with the darker ones. I also added more of these models such as the grass and the dead bushes. I picked up a transparent images of trees, also known as billboard, and put it far in the background so that the scene feels bigger than it actually is. I also tweaked the volume a bit, used a gradient texture to make the effect of fog getting denser as it goes away from the camera, and used it to control the density of the fog. I added even more details like the little button on Satsuki's shirt, which I forgot to add before, and also the leaf on Totoro's head, which I made using a subdivided plane again with some tweaks, and extruded a stalk from the middle. I used a subsurf and solidify modifier on it to finish it up, though it's a shame that it wasn't even visible in the final render because of how dark the scene was, and being me, I was just too lazy to render it a third time. I added additional details like the moss on the bottom of the pole. I used my own pack of procedural moss, smudge and dirt nodes for this part. It's as easy as appending the moss node group from the project and using mix nodes to mix it with the existing textures. You can get this package from my Gumroad page as well as on my Patreon for $3 a month. I tweaked the volume a bit more and played around with the camera placement and depth of field, and when I was happy with how it looked, I set up the necessary render settings and sent it to a render farm to get rendered. I mainly use ConciergeRender for my projects, by the way, because of how cheap it is. I got got my scene rendered at 2K resolution with 2048 samples in 20 minutes at $0.4, which is much better than blowing up my laptop and then buying a new one just to render my scene out. They're not sponsoring me to say it, nor am I an affiliate in any way. I just really like their services, so I decided to share it in this video. Finally, once the render was done, it was time for post-processing, and I can't stress the importance of this step enough. Let me go over how I post-process my scene to make it look better before we end this video. I use Photoshop for this step, but you can use whatever you want. You can even use the Blender compositor if you want to. So first up, I color corrected the entire image using the camera raw filter. There are better ways to do this, but I'm just more comfortable with sliders than curves, so this is what I prefer. So I tweaked the temperature, exposure, contrast, highlights, shadows, and all that good stuff till I was happy with it. Then I went straight to the color mixer to play around with the individual colors and change the hue, saturation, and luminance. Then I tinted the shadows with a bluish color and the highlights with a warm color, and I also gave it a little bit of vignette effect so that the focus is drawn into the center of the shot. After that, I added a rain overlay image and set the blending mode to screen and then rotated it to match the reference. I also duplicated this and scaled it down and duplicated to the other side again so that we have some smaller drops as well. I did the inverse of that as well. I duplicated the original and scaled it up to get bigger drops, almost as if they're close to the camera. Then we can apply a Gaussian blur to it to really sell the effect. I also decided to add a tiny amount of fog in the background, and so I used this misty overlay image. To get it to start fading in from the background, I decided to use the mist pass that I rendered and adjust it a little. I turned the highlights into a selection using a color range selection tool and then added a mask to the smoky image, and then I set it to screen blending mode and adjusted the fill amount. I also added a new layer and painted some areas with black to darken them. I added another layer with a soft light blending mode and a lighter version of the color of Satsuki's shirt and painted over it to brighten it up. Similarly, I also brightened up the skin, skirt, and eyes of both the characters. I added one more layer set to screen, used a brush which resembles scattering raindrops, and just painted it on top of the objects where the rain will bounce off of, mostly the umbrellas. I used a bigger size for some areas to make it look more dynamic, to make the scattering look bigger. Similarly, I added it on the other umbrella, the pole, some on the rocks, and on the ground. Finally, I added another layer set to soft light and used the soft brush to add some shadows and highlights to make it look more stylish. I used a smaller brush to add some rim lighting to the characters to exaggerate the effect. As a final touch, I also decided to add the mist pass with screen blending mode and a very low fill to lighten the background just a little bit. It really helped to add a lot of atmosphere into the scene. So yeah, that's all there was to this scene. I'm really proud that I was able to pull it off, and I'm satisfied with the result. If you guys are still watching till this point, thank you so much. I know this was long, and your support means just a lot to me. Now, if you enjoyed watching this video, then make sure you show your appreciation by liking, subscribing, and commenting on this video. Make sure to follow me on Instagram at HDRIs, where I share work in progress reports and memes regularly. I've also started a Twitter account, which you can follow at HDRIs. And also make sure to check out our Discord server, where we host cool events like monthly Blender contests, where you can get rewarded with awesome stuff for your creativity and storytelling skills. In fact, there's one still going on, which will end in 2nd of October. So if you're interested, make sure to join and participate. If you really like what I'm doing and you want to support me further, you can do so by buying this scene from my Gumroad page or by supporting me directly through Patreon and get some even more awesome stuff every month. Speaking of Patreon, I want to thank my patrons for their help. Treligan, Max Chandler, Marion Meir, Master Zeon 1001, Jovin Zavero, Will, Napa Nong, Tony Simon, and CCCYKRO. So yeah, that's it. Thanks for watching, everyone, and I'll see you guys in the next video.